Good morning, this is Kim Hammer, pastor of Saline Baptist Church, community of Tull outside Benton, with your morning devotion taken from the book of Deuteronomy chapter 11, picking up on verse 16. Moses is continuing to charge the nation of Israel prior to them going over to the promised land, and he gives them a word of caution beginning in verse 16. He said, "Be careful not to entice or to turn away and worship other gods." This has always been a constant theme throughout the time that Moses has spent with the nation of Israel because of the desire and sometimes because of the inability for the Israelites to maintain spiritual control themselves, and they were enticed or induced away from worshiping God nor to worship other idols. In this case, he puts a specific punishment that would go with it, and he says, unless God should cut off the rain from the land. And we may think that that's unusual or that God wouldn't do that. And, you know, sometimes I think that's the way people are. They think, well, surely God wouldn't be that mean, or he wouldn't punish me that hard for doing this particular sin or that particular sin. But God has a standard of punishment that's appropriate to the level of sin that we commit. The one thing God will not do is let sin go unpunished, because he knows if he does, that's the same thing as him condoning the action by not holding us accountable for our action. We look to the book of 1 Kings chapter 17 and verse 1, and actually Elijah said to Ahab back then, when the rain had been cut off for multiple years, and the reason the rain was cut off for multiple years was because Ahab had led the nation to worship the god of Baal, and the god of Baal had taken place in the nation of Israel over that of God. And so God fulfilled his word when he warned him through the prophet Elijah, "I'll cut off the rain for multiple years," and they had, and everything was drying up. Now, whether God would do that to us today as a nation, to cut off our rain or to cut off the natural resources, I cannot say. But what I can say is that God will not let sin go unpunished. In some way, some form, some fashion, he is going to hold us accountable, both as individuals, but collectively as a nation, for our sinful actions. And we do not want to be on the punishing side of God, because we'd rather be on the loving side of God. As much as God loves us on one side, he is capable to punish us to the other side in order to bring us back into a right relationship with him. He goes on and he says in verse 18 that he gives them a solution so as not to let this happen, that they would go after other gods and that they would find themselves in a position where God would have to punish them because of their actions. He says four simple things, and these are things that he has said before, so he reiterates them here. He says, fix these words on your hearts and on your mind. In other words, give attention to the laws and the decrees and the commands of God and make them a matter of focus in your hearts and in your mind, so that when you are tempted to go away from the Lord, these words that are ingrained in your heart and in your mind will come to the surface, and we will remember what God's word says, and we will remember that God does what he says he will do. He also says, again, teach them to your children, because that's a gift of love that we can give to our children, is to teach them the ways of the Lord. Satan is teaching them the ways of the world, and we see how that's turning out when we see the collateral damage of ruined lives scattered all across the landscape of our nation, of this world. That's certainly not God doing that. That's Satan doing that. And so God wants us to teach the right ways to our children, so at least they will understand they have a choice and they have an option. Embrace them. That is the teachings of the Word of God 24/7. You know, we live in a society that's pretty much 24/7. You can go anywhere 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and find whatever it is that you want, because that's the kind of nation that we have. In the same token, we should be that conscientious about the Word of God and it having its preeminence in our life, whether it be in our hearts or in our mind, that 24/7 we have to live on guard in order to guard against Satan taking us away from the Lord. And then he said, have them in front of you wherever you go. So whether it's in the Old Testament days, it would be above the doorpost when you would leave, or, you know, upon the little tablet that would be on the forehead. Today we might say, have the scripture taped to the mirror, or have the scripture taped to the sun visor, or have it taped on the inside of your notebook, or have it taped inside the kitchen cabinet. So when you open the door to get your cup or what a glass or whatever, your food, it's there. Put it on the inside of the refrigerator. Put it on wherever. Just keep it in front of you so that you're conscientiously reminded on a regular basis about the Word of God. Wherever it is not conscientiously placed, it is a void for Satan to take possession of and create other opportunities to lead you away from the Lord. In verse 22, how do you show you're obeying these commands? Three simple steps. Love the Lord your God. walk in all of his ways, hold fast to him. These are three things that seem simple, yet they are so challenging, because Satan is competing for the love that we have in our life, and he wants it for himself and the ways of this world, not for us to dedicate it to the love of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Walk in all these ways. We know that there are many temptations along the journey of life to, you know, go wayward off the main road. But God reminds us that we should walk in his ways, because his ways are the safe ways. And then hold fast to him so that he can hold fast to us and to protect us. Now, the reward is this. To Israel, it specifically applied, God said he would drive out their enemy. To us today, it's the same thing. If we apply these principles that I'm sharing with you, that Moses was sharing with the nation of Israel, our reward is that God will drive the enemy out of our life. It doesn't mean the enemy won't confront us. It doesn't mean the enemy won't attack us. It doesn't mean that the enemy won't lie in wait for us. But what it does mean is that God will drive the enemy out of our lives. You know, we only have so much brain space. We only have so much heart space. We only have so much physical space. All of the space that we have should be entrenched in giving as much of it to God as we can, so that Satan will not find the weakness within our space in order to dominate us. And that's what God is trying to tell us, that if we will place more of him in our lives, he will drive out the enemy from our lives. Second thing he says is, he'll expand your territory, and then you'll hold your territory, and no man will be able to stand against you. Now, in the nation of Israel, he was talking in a physical sense. But today, we could apply that to a spiritual sense, that we would want to expand ourselves spiritually. And as we expand ourselves spiritually, we hold what we have, and we won't regress, and we won't backslide. That the territory that we take in our hearts and our minds that are spiritually claimed for God, that we will not surrender it to Satan, because Christ will take a stronghold in our life and help defend us, so that nobody, including Satan, will be able to stand against us. Now, he closes out the chapter by reminding us there's a blessing and there is a curse. He says, if you obey my commandments, I'll give you a blessing. If you disobey my commandments, I will give you a curse. Now, specifically said, if you disobey my commandments by following other gods. And then he puts a real key phrase in verse 26. He says, which you have not known. In other words, they have known many false gods in the nation of Israel's history. They had a long accumulated list of other gods that they had served. But yet, this implies that there are other gods that they have not encountered that are going to be offered up to them. Let me tell you, as a child of God, one of the good things that we can claim is that we have one God and we don't have multiple gods that we have to divide ourselves among in order to appease, or that we don't have to go to in order to find the multiple things that we all desire to have, and that is a personal relationship with Christ as our Savior. God is a singular God. He is the only God. He is the great God, as we have studied in his word. And we find that Satan has duplicate gods, because in none of those gods alone can they offer what our God offers us. And that's why we should remain dedicated and committed to God, because he is a singular God that loves us with an unlimited, unconditional love. Whereas Satan tries to divide us and to splinter us and to spread us out so as to weaken us and to get us in a vulnerable position. Now, God said in the promised land there were going to be two mountains, and one mountain was for the blessing and one mountain was for the curse. The mountain for the blessing was Gerizim, and the mountain for the curse was Ebal. These are two separate mountains, and they have two separate purposes, and they have two separate meanings. One was for the blessing, of which the blessings would be given to the nation of Israel, but if they were living in a manner in which God would have to curse them, that pronouncement would be made from that mountain. Why two mountains? Because they represent two different principles. Let me give you two verses of scripture that align with this, and then we'll close. In the book of James, chapter 3, 10 through 12, the Bible says, out of the same mouth came praise and cursing. This should not be. Can both fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? My brothers, can a fig tree bear olives or a grapevine bear figs? Neither can a salt spring produce fresh water. James, chapter 3, 10 through 12. Then in the book of Revelation, chapter 3, verses 15 through 16, I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either cold or that you were one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. He's speaking to the church at Laodicea. We find that God has a principle represented in these two mountains. You have to make a choice, and God gives you opportunity to make a choice. Live a life where he can bless you and come to the mountain where you'll receive the blessing. Live a life where he has to curse you and you'll go to the mountain where he has to pronounce the curse upon you. But the time that we want to spend is time on that mountain that gives us the blessing. In verse 31, he said, when you enter and take over and you are living there, be sure that you obey all the decrees and laws I'm setting before you today. Encourage you. Take up the mountain of blessing and leave behind the mountain that brings the curses. It is a choice. He said in verse 31, when you enter in, those that have entered into eternal life knowing Christ as our Savior, we should use our lives to bring blessing and glory to God, and he will bless us back. Let us not be a curse, either to man or to God, so that we don't spend any time on that mountain.